you're the only one I see. V is very, very extraordinary. E is even more than anyone that you adore can love. Is all that I can give to you. Love is more than just a game for two. Two in love.
That is right. Hey, we're talking about love tonight. If you haven't been with us, we're in a series right now called Intentions. What were the intentions for God's love? What's the intentions of love? What's the intentions of dating? What's the intentions of marriage? And so tonight we're going to have something special. We've had, I've shared, we had Pastor Luke share, and then tonight we're going to have the amazing Amber and Lizzie. They're going to share about their perspective, right? Yeah, give it up. Give it up for Amber and Lizzie. They're amazing. So we're going to answer some questions, and then we're going to jump into kind of their testimony and their perception of God's intentions for love through Scripture, and how we can better have better relationships, better friendships, all of the love, anything that love touches, it's better when we involve God in it. So we're going to answer just a few questions before we jump into it. So we've got some student kind of sponsored questions, and we'll kind of go back and forth and answer these tonight. But number one, let's start off with this one. Number one, how do you know if someone is genuinely pursuing God? How do you know if someone's genuinely pursuing God? I'm going to answer this first one and just say this. You know it by the fruits of their labor. You're like, man, I really like this guy or I really like this girl. But how do I know if they're like, if they're saved? How do I know if like they're of like, they're on the same right path, right? We talked about that. I was like running circles around the room and I was saying, hey, when you're running your race, you got to find somebody that's running the race with you. How do you know if they're running their right race, right? I would say it's by the fruits of their labor, right? So if you're like hanging out and you're like, well, they worship on stage and they seem like they read their Bible during service, but how are they outside of it? Does their language follow? Like I encourage you this. If someone's pursuing God, they're not doing drugs, all right? If they're pursuing God and they're chasing after what God has for them, they're not using a bad language and cussing, right? The fruits of their labor. If they're following after God, they're going to be loving to people and not be a bully. So see, in the moment that you look through, okay, how can I know if somebody's really chasing after God? You see it in their fruits. Are they kind, considerate? Are they examples of what Jesus was when he was here on this earth? Are they someone that shows examples of Jesus, or are they not at all? Next thing, we have a question, and so this one is, what are good boundaries? Amber, what do you think are good boundaries in a relationship? Oh, you need a microphone. I'm so sorry. Here we go. I totally dropped the ball. Here we go. Here's the microphone. Trusty, dusty microphone, there you go. What do you think are good boundaries in a relationship?
So I was totally going to yell across the room, but I thought that would be inappropriate if I was just like, well, boundaries! It's okay. So I totally think that good boundaries when establishing a relationship are any boundaries that are rooted in what God has orchestrated in life, right? So obviously you are not to be intimate with somebody before marriage, okay? So first and foremost, don't be doing the horizontal tango before you're married, okay?
Shucky ducky.
Don't be doing that, right?
Slippy. All right.
But I think that the biggest thing, the biggest question that I get across the board is how far is too far? How far is too far? And if you have to question it, it's too far. If you're questioning it in your brain, if you're like, oh, am I going too far with this? Is this going to affect me negatively in the future, then it is too far. And sometimes that's going to be different across the board. Maybe that means stopping at a point that other people don't stop at. But that's kind of where we're at as Christians. We're doing things that are not the ways of the world. So your friends that are in high school that maybe aren't saved are doing things that you're not going to be doing, and that's okay. Because you are holding a standard for yourself, your partner is holding a standard for themselves, and you are acting in a relationship that is founded on God's principles.
Love it. All right, and then to Lizzie, what is the difference between liking and loving someone? What's the difference? What do you think the difference is?
That's a good question. I would say like the biggest difference between liking and loving is liking comes naturally. We like our friends, we like TV shows, like we like foods, but love is more of a choice.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, I have to choose to love Ryan every day. I have to choose to love God every day. Like, I have to make conscious decisions to act out of love. So I think that that's, like, the biggest difference.
And if you missed it, we're engaged. So when she was saying me, that's the only reason why. We're not, like, flirting on stage right now in front of y'all. That'd be weird, right? It'd be like,
got it.
You do? Like, oh, my gosh. Like, what if that was the first time? That'd be hilarious, right? If that was like, she loves me. That'd be really nerve-wracking, right? But hey, tonight we're going to be talking about kind of their perspective and their testimony. And so right off the bat, Amber, I just want you to jump into kind of what do you believe sets our intentions and what sets our standard for love? And how does God love us? Simply not.
So cool. I think when approaching this topic of what it means to love somebody or what it means to be in a relationship with somebody, whenever you don't know how to do something, how many, like, look it up on Google. So if you're like, I need to fix something and I don't want to pay somebody to fix it, so I'm going to go on Google, I'm going to go on the internet, and I'm going to figure out how to do it. But the thing about relationships, the thing about love is that there's no real handbook for it other than what you see on TV, other than what you see on the internet. And the problem with that is one, it's not safe. It's not safe to look up how to be in a relationship or a godly relationship on the internet unless there's a pastor talking at you, right? But the other thing is that when you see it on media, there is a preconceived notion on how that's supposed to look like. So I think of Disney Channel original movies where the girl is sitting in the cafeteria and the guy walks in with all his friends and everything's in slow-mo. I don't know why that is, but everything is in slow motion and he's walking across the room and she sees him and she's like, that's the only person I want on the face of the earth. That's the only thing I need is to be in a relationship with that guy. And that's not always how that works. Another example that I have is this Jerry Maguire movie. I don't remember what it's called, but at the middle of the movie, when everything is at its highest peak, this guy is looking at his love interest, and he has tears streaming down his face, and he's snotting everywhere, and he says, you complete me. And it's hard because as a single person, hearing that, you're my other half, you're my better half, you complete me, it makes me feel like, or it makes single people feel like, that we're walking around like a half a person. And that's not the truth, right? It is unrealistic and it is unfair to make one singular person your everything.
Yeah.
It is unrealistic and it is unfair because what it does is you're upset because they're not meeting your expectations of perfection. And they're upset because they can't meet your expectations of perfection. Two imperfect people cannot make a perfect relationship. The only way that you can have a relationship that is great is when it is founded upon God. When you both have God in your center, when you both are founding your relationship upon God's principles. And so, what does it mean to be complete in Christ first before you are in a relationship with someone else? It means that you are content inside and outside of a relationship. It means that you know how to give love, but you also know how to receive love. And it also means that you can set healthy boundaries, that you can let go of your past, and that your past doesn't need to be your present, and your present doesn't need to be your future. If you're not living the way that God has intended you to live, you can change that today, and you can make those healthy boundary choices. Ephesians chapter 3, 17 through 19 says this. Then Christ will make his home in your hearts as you trust in him. Your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep his love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to understand fully. Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God. So the first thing that I get from that is God loves to be with you. When it's saying in the scripture what Christ will make his home in your hearts, think about your home. The people that are welcome there, the people that own the home, are the people that are inside the home long term. Yes, you'll have guests. Yes, you'll have neighbors come in for dinner. Yes, you'll have other people visit. But the exclusive access to the home belongs to the people that live there. Yeah. So when when Christ is entering your heart, which comes when you give your heart to him and you experience salvation, God now has principle over what enters your heart. God now has principle over what enters your mind, over what enters your spirit, over what enters your entire life. Your circle is determined by what Christ says, right? And so when so what I would say for this is your home has no room for strangers. So if you're in here right now and you have an off-putting definition of relationship, or your relationship is not what Christ is saying, your home has no room for strangers. And you can choose today to make Christ Lord over your life, and you don't have to be subject to what relationships are not. And you can enter into what relationships actually are. And the second thing that I get from this is understand the characteristics of his love, and that's how you're going to be complete in Christ. It says in chapter 18, know how wide, how long, how high, and how deep his love is. How wide is God's love? It's wide enough for every person in creation, okay? So it's wide enough for you no matter what you've done. You can't run away from it. You can't unearn it, because you couldn't earn it in the first place, but you have it, and you have it forever. That person that you got in the fight with in first grade over a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, yes, he loves them too. That person that's sitting in jail right now on death row because they did something terrible, God loves them too. He loves every single person in all creation, and that love is never going to run out. How long is his love? It's long enough to reach from now to the rest of eternity. From the time of creation, when creation began, all the way up until now, he saw your first steps. He saw you learn to ride a bike for the first time. He saw you. He saw me when I graduated high school. He saw me when I entered college, and he saw me through every embarrassing stage of my life. He knew me when he had braces. He knew me when I had braces, so I know he loves me forever, right? And it's high enough to reach you in moments where nothing can get you down. Going back, one of the greatest moments of my life was actually when I graduated high school, not just because I got to be out of high school, but because I also got to give the commencement speech. And that was one of the greatest moments of my life. That was when I knew I was called to speak publicly to people. Maybe not in ministry, but that was when I knew that I had a calling in speaking to other people and encouraging them in this world. Another great moment was when I was called into ministry. That was at the end of fine arts, and I was so excited, and I was ready to tell the world, like, oh, I'm called to preach, I'm called to be a worship pastor, and it was amazing, right? But God knew me, and he loved me in those moments, even when I wasn't even seeking his love, even when I wasn't looking for it because I was on the top of the world, he still loved me in those moments. And also, it's deep enough when you feel like no one can understand how low you are in your emotions. I've had some low moments too, and I know that God has loved me through all of them. And so it's amazing to see through all of these things, through all of these mediums, God can love us, and it chases us forever. And that is how I know that I am complete in Christ, when I can acknowledge that love, and when he has made his home in my heart.
Yeah, that's so good. I love what she's saying there, and then she kind of brought up a bicycle ride, or maybe you're trying to do something for the very first time. I remember, like, a great example of, like, knowing God's love. You can't do something unless, like, you learn how to, right? Talk about Google, right? How many of you have ever gone maybe, like, snowboarding or skiing? Have you ever done that before? We live in Michigan, right? It snows. It's like there's nothing else to do in the winter. You go skiing, right? I went for the very first time, and the most terrifying thing in the world, I think, is a ski lift, okay? I don't understand why they're illegal. I don't understand why it's like a normal thing, right? Everywhere else you go in the world, if you're that high up, there's like a safety net, a safety bar. But for some reason, when you go on a ski lift, you're like a million miles in the air, and you've got what? Like a bar. And it's like a choice if you want the bar. If you're not cool, if you put the bar down, you like keep the bar up. If you're a nerd and you're like scared, then you put the bar down. And so immediately I put the bar down. And I was like, I'm putting this bar down. I'm terrified of what's going on right now. And my friend's like, you're not even cool. Slapped it back up, right? And now the only thing separating me from falling down and dying is just my willpower to jump. And you ever have in your mind, or you're like driving in the car and you're like, no, don't do that, right? That's how I feel like. Well, Tom, I'm in the thing. I'm like, I'm gonna fall. Should I just jump? Should I just do it? And I'm like, no, right? What's wrong with our brains to do that, right? But the moment I got off the ski lift, I never had, like, skied before, and that's the worst part, is you have to, like, kind of sit there and, like, immediately start skiing as a ski lift is about to, like, ram into you. And if it hits you, they have to, like, hit the red button, and the ski lift guy comes over, and he's like, come on, kid, get up. I'm a grown adult this time, right? And so I don't know how to ski. I jump off the thing, and it smacks me over. The thing's going way faster. I'm on the ground. My ski's detached. I threw a pole in the air. It landed on an old lady. She's screaming out, you know, and I'm now on the ground, and the guy's like, bam, hits the red button. And I was like, oh, this is so embarrassing, right? See, I did not know how to ski, and so I only hurt myself and others when I did something I didn't know how to do. And see, the problem so many times is we jump into love relationships, we jump into dating, or we jump into this area of dating in our lives, and we don't know what we're doing, and we hurt ourselves, and we hurt other people. Our characteristic and our lessons on love and our skiing lessons for life on how we operate is not through looking and watching others. If I watched somebody else, I promise you I did. I was watching the person in front of me. I was watching the next person. I was like, okay, they put their feet out. They put their. What happened? What? I still didn't do it. Why? Because I didn't know how to do it. See, the problem is so many times we jump into relationships without knowing how to love. And first, our teacher, our ski slope guide, whatever they're called, is God. We look to him to understand the intentions of love, and then we love from that. And then one day, like I said, you're running your race, and you're chasing after God, and you're doing what he's called you to do, whatever it may be. You'd be like, oh, I'm called to ministry. Maybe I'm just called to be a banker. I'm called to be a dentist. I'm called to fix cars. I'm called to do this. I'm called to that, wherever life leads you. And you're running, and next thing you know, there's somebody running with you, and now you've learned how to love because you first loved God. See, that's our characteristic. See, and I love that. It's so good, Amber. Great analogy of everything that you talked about is so good. Now, Lizzie, I want you to share your testimony. And there's a lot of story. I heard some of what she was talking about. There's some fallacy in her thing about me, okay?
It's all true.
I just want to let
it's
you know
true.
As you start off. Mm-mm. I am an athletic machine, okay? I can't be beaten anything. So whatever she says, let's look through it through that lens, all right?
No.
So tell us, Lizzie, what's your context on what it means to be the intentions of God's love for us? Like, what does it look like in relationships? And share your testimony with us.
Yeah. So just first off, if any of you guys don't know who I am, I'm usually the person that, like, runs around in the back with the camera. I hate being on stage. So, like, this is a whole new thing for me. But I'm super excited to be up here because I feel like God has placed something on my heart that I just kind of want to share with you guys. So I feel like a lot of times when we talk about singleness, I'm going to talk about being single. I love being with Ryan, but my single life was a very important time for me in my life. And I feel like a lot of times when we talk about singleness, we partner it with loneliness. And we're like, oh, that person's single, they're lonely. I felt like that. I'm like, oh, I'm single, I'm lonely. But no, I think God wants us to use this single time where, yes, we may not be with another physical person, but he's like, hey, I'm here, and I want to have a relationship with you. So even in those times where you may not have another relationship with another person, God still wants to have a relationship with you. And so what does that look like is what we're going to talk about. So me and Ryan started dating in 2021, but back up 1 year to 2020, I had decided to do a year of not dating. So I did a year-long commitment to God and to myself to kind of strengthen that relationship. And, you know, at the beginning of 2020, it was super easy because we were all locked in our houses. Like, I had no one to date. So, like, it was just me, my mom, my dad, and my brother. Like, there was no one. So I was like, this is easy. Like, I got this. And then comes May time when, like, quarantine's kind of ending and we're kind of starting to, like, see each other again. I was like, ooh, I'm, like, kind of nervous that I'm going to, like, break my, like, commitment to God. So I actually texted one of my close friends, and we actually have that text. I still have it. I don't know if we do have it, but anyway, so I texted one of my close friends, and I was just like, hey, like, I need you to keep me accountable. I made this commitment to God. Like, I don't want to give that commitment up. And I was like, you know, I highly, highly doubt, like, it's even going to be an issue. Like, it won't be a problem. Yeah, there it is. So I literally said, I highly doubt this will be an issue, but I'm not going to go out with anyone or even entertain the idea of a relationship until at least 2021. Little did I know that this guy was going to come along and try to, like, flirt with me and be sweet with me, and I was going to have to, like, stick to my commitment. Like, he's over here, like, bringing me gifts at work, and, like, I didn't find this out until later, but, like, buying me things for my birthday and, like, doing all these special things, making it really hard for me to stick to my commitment that I made to myself and that I made to God. But the whole reason that I did it was at that last part of the text where I said, but I just want to focus on myself, and I need someone to make me accountable to that. So, like I said, I was doing this whole commitment with God, but the reason why I was doing that was because in 2019, December, November, I got some really, like, devastating news that caused all these insecurities and doubts about myself to come to the surface. See, I'd always grown up in church. I've always heard stories about how God loves you, God's called you, he's created you. But in that moment, all of those things that I had been taught, I didn't believe them. I was insecure. I was doubting myself. I wasn't believing what God said about me. And so I was like, God, like, I was praying to God, and I was like, you know what? Like, I know you say these things about me. I know that you care for me, but, like, I don't feel it. And, like, I need to feel loved, and I want to feel your worthiness and what you say about me. And so I remember I was crying out to God, and he said, clear as day one time, he said, Lizzie, you already know the plans I have for you, and you already know what I think of you. And so my question for you guys tonight is, do you know what God thinks of you? So if you want to open your Bibles with me to Exodus chapter 3, verse 11, this is in the story of Moses. So Moses has already fled from Egypt at this point, and this is during the burning bush. So God is kind of explaining to Moses what he's going to have him do in this next chapter to set the people free from slavery. He's like, Moses, I got this huge plan. You're going to set your people free. There's going to be plagues. There's going to be fire, all these things, and you're going to do it. And here we see Moses' response to that call from God. It says, but Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? So immediately after God has just cast like this huge vision and this huge plan, Moses is like, but like, why me, God? Like, why do you want to use me? Like, wait a minute. And God responds to that. He said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. See, in this moment, Moses was so consumed with what he saw in front of him and his own qualifications. He was like, you know what, God? Like, I can't speak very good. I can't do this. You know what, God? I just murdered one of them. They're never going to listen to me. And so he was so consumed with what he thought were his disqualifications that he missed for a moment how big God was and how much it outshined his, what he thought disqualified him. And what's crazy about that is we do the exact same thing in our lives. When God has all these things for us, he has relationships for us, he has plans for us, we hold out our hands and we say, God, I'm not pretty enough. God, I'm not strong enough. God, I'm not smart enough based off of what I see in front of me. And God is saying, no, 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 no. In my book that I wrote to you, my love letter called the Bible, I've already told you that you're beautiful enough. I already told you that you're strong enough and that you're smart enough. And so, like I said, like, he literally wrote a whole love letter to us that explains what he thinks about us. So I'm going to read some of those examples. Genesis 1:27 says, so God created man in his own image, in the image of God. Jeremiah 1:5 says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I set you apart. And then Luke 12:7 says, even the hairs on your head are numbered. So I love what Amber talked about. She talked about God's love in this vast and big way, and that's so true. God has love that is big and that is wide, but he also has personal love. God knows the numbers of hairs on your head. God created you while you were still in the womb. So yes, he has this big love for you, but he also has a very personal love, and he wants to build that in a relationship with you. So the first thing I want to talk to you guys about, number one, is we cannot love others well until we love ourselves well. And how do we love ourselves well? We get close to God. Why? Because God is love. Hebrews 1:3 says, we love because he first loved us. See, when I made that commitment to God, that commitment to myself in 2020, I came to a point where I was like, you know what, God? My self-worth and what you say about me and my relationship with you is more important than any other relationship. See, God wants you to come to a point where you're like, you know what, God? I need to first give myself to you before I can give myself to anybody else. So we're running around and we're jumping into these relationships. And like Amber said, we're jumping in as half of a person and we're wondering why it's not working out or why we're not getting filled. And it's because we're not running first to the one who's going to fill us up the right way. So the second thing that I want to talk about is the best of the best love. See, once I started to love myself and love God and work on myself and fill myself up with love from God and from myself, I saw it affecting the way that I treat my other relationships. I started treating my friendships better because I was already filled with love myself. I wasn't worried about myself or filled with my own self-doubt. I was able to lift up my friends and encourage my friends because I was already filled with love. I was able to work on the relationship with my parents because I was then filled with love. I was able to strengthen that relationship and see the need in that relationship. So once we're filled with that love, we can pour it out onto other people. Because the best thing that we can do for ourselves is love ourselves, but the best thing that we can do for others is to love others. Because the greatest commandment is what? It's love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. And the second is love your neighbor as yourself. So you need to love God first so you can love your neighbor second. So, and then I see this play out because Ryan's my best friend, right? He's not just my fiance, but he's also my best friend. So if I would have never practiced loving my best friends well, I would have never known how to love Ryan as a friendship, in a friendship form. Does that make sense? Like, if I had never practiced being selfless with my friends, I would have never known how to be selfless with Ryan. So I have an example, just kind of put this into perspective. So we went to New York City, me, Ryan, and a bunch of our friends. This is before we were dating. We all went to New York City. We're, like, walking around the city. We're going into thrift shops. We're, like, touring, all this stuff. And one of my friends is like, we should go to an ice cream museum. And we were like ice cream that we can get anywhere? Like, not just from New York? She's like, yes, we should go eat some ice cream. And so not only did we have to, like, go to this ice cream museum, but we had to pay to, like, go to this ice cream museum. So we're like, so instead of, like, spending our time, like, you know, seeing the bridge and seeing all these things, like, we're just going to go eat ice cream? But in that moment, I was like, okay, no, like, I need to practice selflessness because, like, this is my friend and I care about this relationship. So, like, it ended up being fun. But, like, in that moment, like, I had to choose to be selfless to honor that friendship. So then once I start dating Ryan, I have to be selfless again. So we're playing. I'm like, hey, you want to play tennis? Because I know he's, like, super athletic and, like, I'm good at some sports. Like, I only really play the sports I'm good at because why would I not play a sport I'm not good at? So I asked him if he wants to play tennis, and I'm like, he's like, yeah, let's play tennis. But, see, I play tennis, like, throughout high school, so, like, I'm pretty good at tennis. But in this moment, I had to be selfless because I wanted to keep playing tennis with Ryan, so, like, I may have let him win so that he would, like, think he was better than me and, like, want to keep playing, and then I could be like, hey, we need a rematch. But, see, in that moment, I had to be selfless and let him win so that it could further our relationship. So it all kind of works out. You learn from your friendships, and you learn from your relationship with God, and both of those can be examples for how you then, in the future, live out a romantic relationship. So like I said, we love God, then we love ourselves, and then we can love others well. And the other thing I want to encourage you guys is no matter what stage you're at, whether you're in the stage of discovering, like, God and his love, whether you're at the stage of loving yourself and growing your confidence, or you're at the stage of loving someone else, is don't rush the process. Because if I would have just done 1 month and been like, all right, sweet, like, I love myself, like, this is great, and then I would have jumped right into a relationship, I wouldn't have given myself the time that I needed to heal and to grow and to trust in God. So I'm not saying everyone in here has to, like, take a year off or whatever. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying is trust the process and be patient at the stage that God has you in. Because there's some of you that you may be single for a while, and that doesn't mean that God's forgotten about you and that he doesn't have a relationship for you. It's because there's things that he's still working on inside of you, and there's things that he wants you to work on inside yourself.
Yeah, so. That's great. That's amazing. See, I remember the story differently. I remember doing really, really, really well at tennis and Lizzie not doing as well. But I began to catch on. I was like, oh, wait, okay, yeah, she is letting me win. She's way better at tennis than me. I'm actually not a supreme athlete, as I think I am. But I will agree with her statement as we're closing this all together, intentions. I'm super excited about what God could really do in the lives of each and every one of you through this series. So if I could just have the keys come up and play. I know I didn't say it before, but as we close out tonight, as I go, if we just have the keys play as we close out tonight. I think that everything that we've said throughout this whole series has been, number one, this number one thing, is that we first have to know God's love for us, and that our love has to be selfless. Like, she told that story of that ice cream place. I love New York City. Like, I got this jacket from New York City. I love, like, the thrift stores in New York City. And Jesse, our friend, was like, hey, let's go to the ice cream museum. And I was like, that thing was in Detroit, like, 2 years ago. It's like, you go in, and it's like, $100, and you go in this museum of ice cream, right? And I was like, I don't understand, right? I was like, we could be in New York City. Just a second ago, we saw, like, rats playing in the sewers, and they were like having little boxing matches, and then you go next over to the side, and there's a guy playing on like his brother's head, and they're making music, and then you go inside the subway, and there's a guy in a Spider-Man costume. It's a little bit inappropriate because it's way too tight, and he's like swinging around doing stuff in front of you in the subway, and you're like, oh my goodness, he's like asking for tips, and you're like, I feel this feels inappropriate, right? You know, and that's the New York City that we were experiencing, and we're experiencing these thrift stores and this amazing, like, you know, Times Square with these amazing signs. And then our friend's like, but I want to go to the ice cream museum. And I was like, oh my gosh, you got to be kidding me. We are in the biggest city in the world. We're like, there's everything that we could ever want here. You go downstairs and there's another thrift store there with amazing jackets. And all I'm thinking about is the sneakers I'm missing out on. I'm thinking about all the pizza I'm missing out on. And instead, we're going to this ice cream museum, right? Now, Lizzie said she liked it. She was like, it ended up being fun. I disagree, okay? I completely disagree. It was like one of those cutesy little photo moments. You walk in, and they give you, like, a scoop of ice cream. Not even, like, good ice cream, too. It's, like, bland vanilla, and it's, like two spoon bites, and you're like, this was delicious. And you're like, okay, I was thinking it was going to be like a feast. You're eating as you go along. They give you one, and then they kick you in this room, and it's, like, a bunch of kids playing with, like, cardboard sprinkles. And I was like, what is going on, right? But I agree with Lizzie. Is that with our friendship group, we all got to do different things. There were some that wanted to go to thrift stores and shop for sneakers and look for, like, grail items that I wanted so badly. And there were some that wanted to go to, like, these Chinese restaurants where you wouldn't even see the waiter, and it would just pop out underneath, like, a little drawer, and you open it up, and it was this really unique way to eat food. And then some people wanted to ride bicycles all up and down the city. And there were some of those activities that I loved, and there were some that wanted to go to ice cream museum. And I was like, what's wrong with you? There was not even like any smart facts. Like, I kind of could respect that if you were like, oh, ice cream is made from cows. You know, that'd be cool to learn. But you know what? Like she said, I never let Jesse know that. I said, you know, I enjoyed the time that I have with my friends. And if I look back and be honest, I ended up really having a good time. And it was in that selflessness that I got to enjoy a part of my friends that I had never experienced before. Right, and so there was finally on this last room, there was this giant, like, fake pool filled with sprinkles. And I was like, oh, this is pretty cool, right? You jump in, it was hilarious. I remember Devontae threw one, like, right in my mouth, and I was like, where has that sprinkle been? And I was like, ugh, like, this is disgusting. It was little, like rubber sprinkles, so the girls would land it and, like, take pictures, and I was like, oh, this is kind of cool, right? There's a diving board off of it. And it was actually a fun little, like, cherry on top to the end of the moment, no pun intended, right? But it was in that selflessness that I got to experience something that I would have never experienced before. And I want to share with you tonight, just to close out this entire series, is that there was a man named Jesus. And he did the most selfless act of love we will ever see. He left heaven. After creating all of the earth, creating the flowers and the dumb ice cream museums and putting the ideas of that in the head, and the ground that was one day would be built on top is New York City, and the places that we would go to, and the places I've gotten to see, and Michigan in the cold winter, and everything else. And he created it all, and it was amazing. And then he made us, and we messed it all up. We came in and we made, like, corruption, and we allowed sin into the world, and we made it really messy and inconvenient. We were the most selfish thing he made. Suddenly now we wanted everything for ourselves. He says, don't touch this fruit. And we said, nah, I want that fruit. That looks so delicious. And next thing you know, we corrupted what love was supposed to be. See, God said, no, I got a plan for that. So Jesus saw the situation, almost like a doctor reading over the pamphlet at the end of our worldly hospital bed, and he reads through and he says, oh, sin. They don't love me anymore. They deny what I've given them. But I still love them. And I bet there's the angels, it's like the nurses. And they're coming up to Jesus, and they're like, Jesus, no, Jesus, you told them not to do this. Like, you were there for them. You walked with them in the garden, and he goes, no, it's okay, I still love them. And he's like, no, Jesus, you don't understand. They're murdering each other down there. They're selfish. They look at things they shouldn't look at. God, they corrupt themselves. They destroy themselves with their own thoughts. And he goes, no, I still love them. And so selfishly he says, you know what? I'm going down there. I'm going to perform surgery. I'm going to be the selfless act. I'm going to be the donor. My whole life will be a picture of how much I love him. So Jesus came to this earth, and he sacrificed himself. As two nails went into his hands, and a nail went into his feet and held him up on a cross, and he died. And sometimes we glaze over that. It's a gruesome death as he was whipped so many times, one lashing away from being dead as glass and brick and rock were sown into these brands of these whips as it tore apart his flesh. He would have died to that alone, but then as this little bit of life is left, they hung him and pierced him and put him on a cross. Meanwhile, as he's doing that, these same people that he created, that he breathed life into, are spitting on him and accusing him and screaming at him and putting nails into him. He says, no, I love him, for they know not what they do. See, we glaze over that even as gruesome as it is, but this is the part we forget, is that feeling you get in your stomach. Maybe the worst moment in your life of you know you did something wrong, and that feeling of heaviness and that feeling of torment and that price of sin that falls on us. Every single moment, every single sin, everything that we would do wrong suddenly fell upon Jesus in that moment. It wasn't just a physical death, but it was a spiritual death as well. Everything that we would do wrong, the things we would say, suddenly now is thrown on Jesus, and the weight of the world is put on him. And he yet still hung on that cross. Every moment, the nurses and angels are watching and saying, Jesus, just give us the word. We'll pull you out of there immediately. Jesus, just give us the word. We'll take you out. And he says, no, I love them. He says, no, I love them. And he dies on that cross. But the greatest part about it is he rose again 3 days later. And he continues to give us that selfless love every single day. Loves you that much. So tonight I would encourage you to not base your love by other people. Do not base your love by a TV show. Don't base what you think love is by maybe past relationships. Don't base your love on what the world says, but base how you receive selfless love by what he did on that cross for us. He says, I love you. Take the beating. I'll take the crown of thorns that went through my head. I'll take the suffering of every sin, every problem, every issue as it sat on me on that cross. I'll take it for you. That's what love is, guys. He is love. And he created us to have a relationship. He created us to share that selfless love. So tonight, I just want to close out this entire intention series with all of the things that we've talked about guarding your heart and how to pursue the right person and how to set the right boundaries and all those things. I want you to catch just this, if you heard nothing else, is that Jesus loves you, and he would have done all that he did on that cross just for you. That's where we define love from. Not our friends' relationships, not how our parents have treated us, not what we've heard through culture, but instead what he did on that cross. When I doubt who I am, I look to that cross. When I don't feel loved, I look to that cross. When I don't think I'll ever be able to love well, I look at that cross. Why? Because he created me out of love. So tonight I want to give just an opportunity, as we've been talking about this great, amazing love and how to take time to figure out who we are and not jump into other relationships before we are whole as a single person. I want you all just to stand on your feet before we close tonight. And I want to give you an opportunity. Tonight, I want to give you the best proposal. Some of you are like, whoa, 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 is he about to propose to us? This is getting a little weird, a little culty. Yep. No. This proposal has been being made to you every single day from the day you were born till you die. Jesus is continually knocking on your door saying, hey, I love you. Will you have a relationship with me? He's been asking. He's been like I was with Lizzie. I was always trying to like drop off gifts, and I was always like, hey girl, how you doing, right? And I didn't know she was like taking a year to not date until someone finally told me. So I was like, what is wrong with this girl? I was like, I'm dropping off gifts, I'm giving extra things. I was like, what's going on, right? That's it's funny and amazing it worked out. But that's the same way that Jesus with us. In a weird is that same way that Jesus is continually knocking on our door, even more than I ever could. Jesus is knocking on your door. He's leaving presence behind. He's constantly trying to get a relationship with you. He's constantly trying to say, hey, let me be a part of your life. I'll make it better, I promise. I want to be involved in your life. I created your life. I know why you're here. I know your purpose. I know your calling. I know your talents. I want relationship with you. I love you. And he's chasing after us. You think, man, oh man, you've had a crush on somebody before? You feel like you've loved somebody before? I promise you, it doesn't even show up on the comparison chart of how much Jesus loves you. It doesn't even compare. And he's chasing after you. So tonight, I want to give you the opportunity to accept that proposal, to accept that invitation to have a relationship with Jesus tonight. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, so that this is a private moment. We're not peeking at somebody else's moment. We're not peeking at their relationship with God right now. But just as a form of obedience, when you get proposed to, when you get asked to be in a relationship, you got to respond. And so tonight, just as a response, if that's you tonight and you want to have a relationship with Jesus tonight, you say, man, I give you my life. I see what you did on that cross for me. I see how you've selflessly loved me my whole life. You've been chasing after me. If that is you tonight, and you say, I want to respond to that, I want to say yes to Jesus tonight. If that's you, just raise your hand right now. Just as an act of obedience, saying yes, I say yes to you, Jesus, tonight. If that's you, come on, just one more second. Just a few more seconds. I love it, I love it. You can put your hands down. Come on, that's so good. That's the best decision you'll ever make. The best relationship you'll ever have is saying yes to Jesus. So with every eye bowed and every eye closed, you can put your hands down. In this moment now, I want you to really think about what Jesus has done for you. And together, even if you didn't raise your hand or if you did, I want you to repeat this prayer after me. If this is simply just saying yes to Jesus, this is a simple prayer. But every eye bowed and every eye closed together, Jesus, I give you my life. I say yes to you. Thank you for dying on the cross for me. Forgive me of my sins. I accept you as my Savior, and I will serve you for the rest of my life. That's all it is. Come on. That's so good. That acceptance is amazing. Now, for the rest of you here in this room, I encourage you, I challenge you, I beg you, I plead you to not let this series just float one ear and float out the other, but I challenge you. From the scripture that we kind of based all of this on, and it's Proverbs 4:23, and it says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything flows from it. That breath of life that God gave you, that heart that he gave you, has a purpose and a reason. Guard it. Relationships will happen. Dumb stuff will happen. Heartbreak happens. It's going to happen. But if you guard your heart and you give it to him first, it doesn't hurt as much. God protects you. He's there for you. He can lead and guide you away from those moments of heartbreak. And instead, you can have a story that says, man, I chased after God and he gave me everything else. I guarded my heart and good things flowed from it. So I'm going to close with a prayer tonight as we end this series. So God, I thank you so much. God, I thank you so much that you loved me. God, that you died on the cross for Ryan. You died on the cross for every single student in this room. You took those beatings and those lashings. You took my sin. You took my most embarrassing moments, my failed relationships, my heartbreak moments, my moments of insecurity, my moments of anxiety. Lord, you took it all for me because you love me. God, help us see that love tonight. Help us walk in that love tonight, God. Help us not be wavered by things of this world or culture, what other things want to say that want to distract us from that selfless love that you gave us. But Lord, help us keep our eyes on you so that we can one day experience great love with every single friend, with every single partner, with every single relationship outside of a romantic, every single person we walk into. We would show them how much you love us. How we love you, God. We thank you that we can't ever compare to how much you love us. We thank you that your love swallows us up. We thank you that your love, we drown in how much you love us, God. We thank you for that tonight, God. Help us to learn from this series. Help us to be different because of it tonight. Help your Holy Spirit, Lord, tonight. We pray that your Spirit would go with us tonight. And Lord, you'd convict us in areas where we need to change. And Lord, you would comfort us in areas where maybe we feel afraid tonight. You would guide each and every relationship that happens in this room. In your glorious, glorious name.